chemistry of beer is very complex. We have thousands and thousands of molecules that make up what we know of as beer. One of the processes that we need to understand how we develop this complex mixture of compounds that give us the color, flavor, and aroma of beer is the Maillard reaction, or Maillard. This reaction is very common. Anytime you have non-enzymatic browning of food, it's the Maillard reaction. It can occur by going very basic solutions, as in browning of pretzels. But it also occurs with high temperatures. So browning your steak or raising the temperature when you're baking a pie to get a nice golden brown and those characteristic flavors that we're used to, these all come from the Maillard reaction. This occurs by the combination of amino acids and reducing sugars. So where do we get our amino acids? Remember that we start with malt, and the malt has protein, lipid, and carbohydrates. The proteins, the first thing that happens whenever we do the malting process is that enzymes start to break the proteins down into free amino acids. Most of the amino acids is going to be used for nutrition for the yeast during the fermentation process. But some of these go into the Maillard reaction to produce the complex colors, flavors, and aromas. If we think about reducing sugars, this comes from our carbohydrates, our amylose. The amylose is broken down into maltose and glucose. Glucose is a reducing sugar. Now, what's the definition of a reducing sugar? Well, if we think about the two forms of sugars, we have aldose and ketose. Aldose is called aldose because it contains an aldehyde functionality. Ketose is referred to as ketose because it has a ketone functionality. Glucose is an aldose. Fructose is a ketose. Now, aldehydes can be oxidized to carboxylic acids, but ketones cannot be easily oxidized. It's the fact that the aldehyde can be oxidized that we call these reducing sugars. Now, why call it a reducing sugar if it's being oxidized? It's because aldoses, aldehyde-containing groups, can act as reducing agents. So it's not what's happening to the sugar, but what the sugar is doing to something else. So a reducing sugar reduces other components. So we have glucose in solution, and we have amino acids. All we need to do to get the Maillard reaction to occur is to heat it up. There's two main processes where we have this occur during the brewing. One is the malting and kilning. If we raise our temperature during kilning, we'll get more Maillard reaction occurring. That's why malts like Vienna or Munich, dark malts, have more of a Maillard type flavor from the components. The other way we can do this is during the boiling process, but we have to be careful. Beers that have characteristic Maillard reaction flavors are often decoction mashed. That's because we can boil, we can really heat up a part of the mash and then pour it back into the original mash solution to raise the temperature. This boiling gives us the temperature we need for the Maillard reaction to occur. Now, how does it occur? What is the chemical mechanism that's occurring? For that, we need to look at the structure and look at that aldehyde. The first thing we need to do is activate that aldehyde. We'll activate the aldehyde by having it react with an acid. Remember that the brewing solution is slightly acidic. Once we have added a proton to that aldehyde, we now have an activated aldehyde group. This is ready for a nucleophilic attack. The nitrogen will attack the carbonyl of this activated functionality and kick up one of the pi bonds. The pi bonds will then give its electrons to the oxygen that has a positive charge. This forms a tetrahedral intermediate where we have a nitrogen that's positive and we have the oxygen or the hydroxyl. At this point, we need to do a couple of proton transfers. Proton transfer, we're just going to use any component with a lone pair, like the A component of our acid, to pull off the proton, give the electrons back to the nitrogen. At that point, we need to do another proton transfer, this time to the oxygen of the hydroxyl group, it'll pick up a proton to give us a protonated hydroxyl or a water. Now, water is a great leaving group, so therefore it can leave. The lone pair on the nitrogen comes back in, kicks off our great leaving group, the water, to give us an imine. Now, an imine is just a carbon double bond nitrogen. So what we've done in this first step of Maillard reaction is to replace the carbon double bond oxygen with a carbon double bond nitrogen. This gives us an imine, which is going to have a different set of functionalities than our original aldehyde. Now, what can happen with this is we can get the same type of cyclization that we would see with an aldehyde in our glucose. So this can cyclize just like we would see with the original aldehyde. Now, this is not going to be that stable, so what can happen is that we can get a second reaction. This second reaction is the amidory rearrangement. The amidory rearrangement takes this imine and rearranges it to get us back to a ketone. The first step is that we're going to lose a proton. This is going to create a double bond between our carbon and our carbon between the hydroxyl and the double bond nitrogen. That means that we have to break one of the pi bonds to the double bond nitrogen. At this point, now we have a nitrogen single bond and a carbon double bond carbon with a carbon oxygen. At this point, we're going to get a rearrangement of our electrons from the oxygen towards the double bond. Then the pi bond will break and pick up a proton from the solution. This proton from solution then will mean that we have a tetrahedral carbon with our nitrogen. So what we've done is convert an imine, a carbon double bond nitrogen, to a carbon double bond oxygen or a ketone. If we lose a proton from our ketone, we'll end up with our ketosamine. Ketosamine is going to then go through several potential processes. It can degrade to give us reductones, where we have two carbonyls right beside each other, or it can go and create other small flavor components. Some of these favorable, some of them unfavorable. Both the ketosamine or the reductones can then go ahead and polymerize with other proteins and other molecules to give us long chain polymers. These are the melodenes. The melodenes give us the characteristic flavors and colors that we expect in beer, those rich, dark tones. The Maillard reaction is very common. It's essential to beer. It gives us some of the flavors and aromas that we're accustomed to, and is very characteristic of certain types of beer.